which was given was very, very vast. So I thought, you know, I'll try to, you know, restrict myself more to the infrastructure part of it, so that which is the core agenda for the discussion today. So what are the typical market trends and the opportunities in the health tech? So these are the trends we have found in the industry. The consumers are increasingly engaged in their managing their own health as well now. The shift to value-based healthcare will reduce the waste, increase the access, and improve the outcomes. The care is shifting to the low-cost settings and also to the homes. And there is a digitization of the healthcare happening. The Philips as a company is now transforming into a health tech company. Right from the diagnosis and treatment to the connected care and health informatics to the personal health, while also being present in the lighting space. So we innovate across the healthcare continuum, right from the healthy living to the prevention to the diagnosis, treatment, and home care. We are providing the propositions for a healthy living. We are supporting the predictive and the preventive care, and we are connecting care into the home to improve the quality of life. So, coming to the hospital infrastructure perspective, whenever we approach anyone from Philips India, people think that we are only into the MRIs and the CT scans and the medical equipments. So that is the time I thought I'll meet all of you and create a mind share about what this division, the healthcare transformation services and infrastructure advisory, is doing in Philips. Philips as a company globally is now moving as a solution company, not just a product company. So we are looking at what are the pain areas for our customers and how can we address those pain areas and provide them solutions. Products definitely would be there and would continue to be there, but then the approach we are going to take would be a solutions approach, providing a solution to the customer pain and using our knowledge of the healthcare domain to help them to solve their problems. Typically, when we talk about building a healthcare infrastructure, a typical promoter or a CEO of a hospital has to deal with multiple agencies, maybe 40 to 50 or more agencies, maybe architects, the interior designers, the contractors, fabricators, vendors, peer reviewers, so on and so forth. The promoters, the CEOs, and other people are engaged for multiple discussions, and they're confused many a times to take an informed decision. That is where we propose to have a Philips integrated project delivery approach, what we call as the IPD approach, not the inpatient, but the integrated project delivery approach, wherein we, that approach would act as a single point of contact, dealing with the multiple agencies, providing the customers a peace of mind to set up a healthcare facility they have in mind. So Philips HTSI has developed the capabilities beyond the equipments to be an end-to-end partner. Typically, whenever the OEMs like Philips or GE or Siemens, they go and meet the customers, people are treating us as vendors, while we want to play a role of a partner there. We want to play a role of doing the hand-holding for setting up their projects. So what we propose is to have an integrated approach, not just limited to the design, but then across the entire continuum. So what we can suggest is to have a strategic advisory, like, you know, right from the techno-economic viability of a place, where the hospital should come, what should be the medical program, what should be the clinical program there. We can help them in the designing of the hospital, the complete designing, the turnkey designing of the hospital. We can also help in the project management of monitoring the project. We can also do the construction management for them. We can do a complete procurement advisory, which is medical, non-medical, Philips, non-Philips. And believe me, whenever I say about procurement advisory, there's a China wall between our equipment division and our division. So it is not that being a Philips HTSI division, we would recommend Philips equipments. We would recommend what the need for that hospital is. We would recommend what would suit that place, what is the specification required, what is the competition, what is the demand supply gap. So all these factors come into the play. So we give a very, very vendor neutral procurement advisory. Finance arrangement, again a very, very crucial topic, particularly after the demonetization. You know, most of the projects are either not coming up or they're delayed. But then Philips as a company can help the doctors and the hospitals to not just raise the debt, but we also help them in raising the equity part. We can help them in preparing the presentations for these financial institutions. We can help them and give our advisory to them on that. We can also do operational consultancy. It means we can give them a pre-commissioning support. We can give them healthcare consulting services. We can give them strategic advisory. We can give them support on turnaround strategies. So typically, basically, if I see about this division, we can do a healthcare consulting part, and we can do the infrastructure advisory part. Now here, I would like to talk about something about the BIM, which is the Building Information Modeling, which is a platform Philips design team has adopted for all their design purposes. And I would like to take you through how this BIM technology is helping us to take more informed and better decisions. So typically, as all of you, most of you are architects and from the technical background, design program is a backbone. So integrated values, goals, facts and needs of the client's organization, facility users, and the surrounding community is very, very important. So whenever somebody asks us about designing a hospital, we need to understand the vision and mission of that customer or that organization. Sometimes we try to jump into conclusion without understanding the vision and mission, and there is a total mismatch between what we are trying to design and what the promoters or the organizations have in mind. So it is very important that we understand their vision and their mission and try to align ourselves to that. Then I think we'll be able to co-create in a much better way and understanding the needs and the pain points. So we spend a lot of time in co-creating, in understanding their pain points, understanding their vision and mission before jumping into the conclusion of right away on the drawing board to design a hospital. Various factors need to be considered during the design, right from the human factor, which is the functional, social, physical, and psychological, safety, of course, the structural, fire, chemical, personal, environmental factors, technological factors, and also the cultural factors. Like one of my friends here was sharing about their experiences in Bangladesh. We are also doing a couple of hospital projects in Bangladesh, and typically we have realized in Bangladesh, with every patient, at least 10 to 15 relatives come along with him. So the space programming, be it in terms of the waiting areas and all that, have to be accommodated for accordingly. So the cultural aspects of various countries need to be considered when we do such kind of decisions. Of course, compliance and safety would be the central to each and every of these kind of decisions. So a well-conceived program in the end leads to a very high quality design. To what extent should technology be embedded into the design stage of the healthcare planning? I said it should be from end to end, right from the concept design, schematic design, the conceptual design and analysis, the design development, and also till the end the documentation part of it. And BIM can be a mode towards the entire journey of it. The early informed design decision improves the cost, quality, and time parameters, and the informed design decisions at a very early stage by doing the energy simulation. Gaurav was mentioning about how these things are done. So typically, within the parameters available to us, maybe there may be site constraints, but yes, in whatever way we can do, we will try to do the site and surrounding analysis, the stack planning and mass modeling, the energy modeling and simulation, and we can look at the green and sustainable design with the focus on the whole building energy analysis, the detailed weather data, carbon emissions reporting, daylighting, water usage, cost, and finally resulting in the final massing of that. All these parameters we need to work out. Definitely there will be constraints from site to site, but then whatever best we can do, we must make an attempt to do that. The modern technologies have improved the outcomes. The BIM modeling, we can detect the real-time clash dissection in virtual 3D model, and it can generate automated clash reports, and it can do a saving also. We can save up to 10% of the contract value through clash detections, and we can save up to 40% of the unbudgeted change. We can eliminate that. So these are the technologies we can actually work on and which can reduce the wastage for us and for the customers as well. So a well-coordinated working error-free BIM model is the technology, how technology can help you for better designs and taking informed decisions. The basic benefit would be, you know, when such kind of integrated approach is taken for executing a project, maybe it would start with a single point responsibility so that there's no finger pointing anywhere. There would be better transparency, better controls, and of course the savings would be there. So we start from the concept design, visualize, develop the design, again analyze that, design it, and then do the final documentation of it. It's a more detailed version. I think with the limitation in the time, we can take it offline during the lunch break. Again, one of the very important parameters while executing a hospital infrastructure project is the project management workflow. The project initiation and setup, the design management, the procurement and tendering, the construction management, the contract administration, and handing over and closing of the site. Having executed many projects myself, I've seen, you know, closing the site is equally important. Most of the sites remain open and it bleeds the contractor, it bleeds the promoter, and finally you're not able to close the site. It is very imperative that we need to close the site and then start the operations of the hospital. So a good project management is equally important as a design management. Now something about BIM, the building information modeling, most of you must be using that platform in your designing, but then just for the everybody's interest, the building information modeling is a digital representation of a physical and functional characteristic of a building. The idea is to create a 3D model or a virtual representation of a real physical building, and each 3D element has an information input into it so that the data can be scheduled automatically and shared downstream with the other members and the stakeholders. We of course start with putting ideas on the paper, then the sketches get converted into a BIM mass modeling for a green building analysis, and the BIM model is shared across the geographies in real time with the other stakeholders, and they can work on the same platform. So simultaneously, the architects, the MEP guys, the equipment guys can work on the same platform, and they can collaborate and share simultaneously across the various geographies on cloud, and integrate and share the ongoing models with the team and also with the client. So the project collaboration, the multidisciplinary collaboration, and the communication becomes very transparent, and that is how we are leveraging technology, and people should leverage the technology for everybody's benefit. We can produce compelling visualizations from the same business model, BIM model, and we can share with the customer, and mostly the doctors, they are very, it is very difficult for them to actually, you know, see a 3D or a 2D drawing and then visualize how the actual, the OPD or the rooms would look like. The BIM modeling can help you to give a actual real-time views so that they can take decisions maybe in terms of the finishes, the colors or whatever, which they are not able to take in a 2D model. So you can communicate better, you can explore the ideas, and you can create better. So we have always taken a route of co-creating it along with the, all the stakeholders, and then sharing with them on this platform so that they can understand what it actually appears to look like. So this is from one of the sites in the Eastern India where we shared with them, this is how your atrium area would look like, and based on their inputs, we changed, made some changes also in that. So this BIM technology can be used in a greater way, and it constitutes of small elements called families, the rivet families and other things, which can give you a lot of information, and you can have your schedules and the quantities defined on that. The 3D coordination and automated class detection can save a lot of money and time at the site during the execution. So it's always better to spend more time on the drawing board than on the, you know, when the project goes live in the construction. So the more discussions you have on the drawing board, it will do a cost and the time saving for you when the project goes under the construction stage. We extract schedule quantities and the COBE data from the BIM model for construction, commissioning, and operating of the building. The COBE data, which is the construction operations building information exchange, is an exchange specification for the information needed by the contractor, owners, and the facility managers. It can reduce up to 80% time in generating the cost analysis estimates, and it with an accuracy of 3%. So the BIM model gives you the data extraction, and that helps you to get all the inputs. With that, we can come out with the room layout sheets and the room data sheets, which gives you all the information you require for your respective building. So these are the ways in the hospital infrastructure execution and design we can use this platform of BIM and try to push that technology for the benefit of the project. So typically in any project, we have seen most of the hospital projects running into cost overruns and time overruns. In fact, last of the hospital infrastructure session we had in Mumbai was focusing on the cost and the time overruns, and the information we got was most of the hospitals during execution were running in either cost overrun or time overrun. So a well-designed hospital with a very good project management team can restrict the cost and the time parameters, and the projects can be executed on time and within the cost framework. So there's a difference in the approach. We need to, you know, take advantage of the technology and the standards and make adherence to the various green building norms and other norms which are available in the market so that we can meet the accreditation parameters. Now, experience design. Gaurav was talking about the experiences in the hospital. So people were talking about whether doctor-centric hospitals or patient-centric hospitals. So we would tell that, you know, it should be people-centric, where we need to also keep in the focus the doctors, the patients, the patient relatives, the hospital staff. So the time has come wherein we need to look at people-centric designs. We should look at people-centric hospitals which can help everyone to be there and reach better clinical outcomes. So experience design is one of the parameters which helps in recovering faster, in healing faster. So ambience design, experience design is coming up in a big way, and most of the hospitals are now looking at those. So the interiors and other things also play a very, very important role, and we need to focus on that. On the operations and the technology part, I would always recommend, because I have been running a hospital also before as a CEO for one of the Apollo hospitals. So when you're finalizing a technology or going for a equipment, I would always recommend to go for the latest technology. Not just because, you know, it may be requiring a lesser space or maybe requiring a lesser power consumption, but then that technology, at least for the next 5 to 7 years, would be there and you'll not reach the technical obsolescence. So whichever technologies you're going for, optimize, of course, you know, you need to look at your cost also, but then you optimize and take a very informed decision that if you can afford the latest technology, it will be there with you for next 5 to 7 years, and you can sustain and compete in the market in terms of, you know, the redundancy in the technology which is happening very fast in the medical equipments and other devices. So whenever you are finalizing a equipment, look at whatever the best technology you can afford. Of course, looking at the viability part of it, don't go for overkill, but then if you can afford the latest technology, go for a latest technology so that you are there for at least 5 to 7 years, you can go ahead with that technology and have those inputs. Again, on the interior part, a very warm and earthy natural experience inside and outside are important, and we as Philips are catalysts for achieving a high-performing and human-centric healthcare environments. Me and my team, including Renu, who's heading the design, Pranjal and Capri are here in the conference throughout the day, and we'll be happy to, you know, answer any of your queries you have and take you through, you know, in detail of some of the things, because I don't want to go too much in detail because of the time constraint, but then we'll be happy to discuss with you to in greater detail what else we can do for you and your teams. So that's it, you know, just wanted to put some light on the technology part which we can use for the benefit of one and all. Thank you so much. If there are any questions, I'll be happy to take.